Welcome to Community Connections. I'm Tom Laux, and today in the studio, I have Pam Ross. She's the president of ODC, and she's going to share a bit of information about ODC and what's happening over there. So Pam, take it away. Tell us about yourself and the mission ODC has.
Well, thanks for having me. As ODC's been around in the community, a lot of people are very familiar with ODC, but there's probably some that aren't familiar. We've been in the community since 1965. We're a private not-for-profit corporation, and our mission is to empower people with disabilities to achieve their work and life goals. ODC's always been about working with individuals who have a variety of disabilities, a variety of needs, but it's really been always primarily about work, helping them get and keep jobs. And then we also have some programs that help them just in other areas of their lives to give them opportunities to learn new skills that are helpful in life and also access the community, learn how to be more integrated and involved in the community.
Well, let's go back in the years, 1965. You have some old pictures of it. We're going to see these here on the show. Let's talk about the progression and how it came about. You started when?
Well, not in 1965,
nope.
So that's a good thing. I've been around for a lot of ODC's okay. existence, though. I started in 1986, so I've okay. spent really the majority yep. of my career, my adult life, has been about ODC. But a really an interesting timeline for ODC when you think back to 1965. Prior to that time, if you were a family or an individual parent that had a child with a disability, once they got out of high school, there really wasn't anything structured. If you were, as I've always said, lucky enough to have an uncle who owned a hardware store that would hire you, maybe you'd have a job after you got out of high school. But really, for the majority of the people, that was the end of their structured life. So 1965 was a year that ODC started because of parents reaching out saying, we want more for our adult children. We want them to have opportunities to work just like everyone else. So it was very grassroots, and it started. We have two locations that have really been there since inception, Wisconsin Rapids and Marshfield. And their goal in the first start of ODC was finding some businesses that would give these individuals a chance to perform some projects. So back then it was called the Sheltered Workshop. We don't call it that anymore. We call it a work center. And also ODC is so much more. If you jump way to today, there's been certainly an evolution that's happened over the years, but really ODC today is a very diverse organization. And we're working with people, again, at all levels of ability, either they're employed and getting training within one of our facilities, or they're working out in the community at a business, or they might be doing both. We have a lot of individuals that enjoy the opportunity to be part-time in the community, and if they don't have enough hours of work, then they work within our facility-based programs. And then, as I mentioned, we also have day services programs, which are intended to teach people life skills. So a person really has the opportunity to do any and all of those things, whatever it is that's on their life goals. They kind of design their program basically around what they want to accomplish.
Well, let's give our viewers a little look through ODC. Let's talk about some of the programs that you have. You've initiated a lot of new ones. I've had a chance to go through mm-hmm. there. We also have a kitchen. We can talk about that. Mm-hmm. But let's just go through some of the really neat things that they have. There's groups of 20, 30, 40 people working at one time. A lot of different things that are there, and how you came up maybe with some of the ideas. I remember jeans were one of them, if I remember right, a couple years ago. Let's just touch base and have our viewers and walk through those steps.
Sure. Well, and again, step back to 1965 for a minute and think about starting something from scratch. And the parents really reached out to really any business that would have something, anything for their individuals to do. And over the course of time, ODC recognized that if we were going to create training and work opportunities, we really needed to be a valued business partner, that we established some real specialty areas that not only would it create those jobs for the people, but it would be something that a business could really, really benefit from. So there's been a lot of ups and downs and a lot of business changes over the years, but we, stepping back, I think one of the first operations that we really took off and developed is the wood area. And that's primarily now in our Marshfield Center, where we do a variety of wood products for businesses that are either I always say it's not the furniture, it might be the furniture part that you don't see that's inside that might be created by ODC, or it's a packaging item that is involved in the packaging of a product that's being shipped, or it might be the shipping crate or shipping pallet. So we've developed some real specialty areas, invested in a lot of equipment. And again, the sole reason, or I guess we always have a dual purpose, it's about the training and work opportunities, but it's also been about generating revenue as a social enterprise. Any not-for-profit will tell you it's very difficult to operate just on the funding that you get from a funding source, and we've been no different than that. So we've always been able to create and generate revenue by having businesses. So we also have specialty areas in packaging and assembly, mailings, fulfillment, those types of operations that get a lot of people involved. As you said, you've come through the facility and seen a lot of different things. And you know, we're looking for those types of opportunities that we can either break something down to a very simple step or have somebody get involved in something pretty technical. Some of the jobs we have are very technical and some are quite simple. But when you look at all the course of time since 1965, some of those business ups and downs that we've experienced have caused us to get creative. A lot of times when you say you saw the jeans, I had even forgotten about that, but we do, we listen. If a business has something that they need done and it's not really in our list of specialty areas, we'll take a look at it. And we'll generally set up a job and give it a try and see if it's, you know, something that we can do. Well, about 5 years ago, when the economy was really struggling, we realized we had to start developing some businesses of our own. You mentioned the kitchen. That was really emerged because of economic changes in our community locally, our national economy. We were losing a lot of the work that we had become accustomed to having. And so we got busy and looked at things that we could do, and we developed Hidden Creek Kitchens, a commercial grade kitchen opportunity for training purposes, but also developed some really, really great food. This week, actually, our internal operations for our kitchens are not available to our employees because we're baking between 9,000 and 13,000 cookies for an external order that we have to deliver daily orders of cookies. So it's really become well known as a great place to buy product, to have catering services, and also a really great learning and training opportunity for people.
And I believe the community is really adapted and love to come there, get your salads, mm-hmm. The cookies, and the people there get a chance to do something they really like to do.
Right.
And use their talents.
Right.
Everyone there has talents just like you and I, and they're able now to use those your place or out in the workforce. Now, so you're training people to come out into the workforce, jobs out in our community. Can you share a few of those jobs that maybe some of them are doing right now?
Sure, and as you mentioned, the facility-based programs really are only one part of what we do, and it really is at when they're in the facility, we're trying to determine what their interests, their skills, their gifts, their talents are, and what would be a good job match for them in the community, and the types of support that they might need if they do get a job in the community. So a really big part of what we do, and a really growing and emerging part of what we're doing, is getting more and more people out in the community. So really, it's getting to know the person first, finding out maybe not necessarily, you know, are they good at this type of assembly, but what are they interested in? What makes them excited? What makes them want to get up in the morning? Trying to find out, because as you know, you're going to succeed more at a job if you like it and if it's something that really fits your internal interests. So a lot of what we do in the facility-based programs is trying to get to know the individual, and also even if they don't work in our facility, a big part of the prep for a job in the community is figuring out what would be a good match. So for instance, if you find out that somebody is very good at organizing things, that they have a very clean house and they like things in a certain manner, you might look at a certain type of job. Maybe it's something in warehousing, or it's something in office where they, you know, have an opportunity to be organized and can have control of the day. If they like, maybe they like to organize things, and shelf stocking at a store might be a really good fit. So once we know those things and we kind of come up with a brainstorm list of ideas of what might be a good job for them, then our job developers will contact our local employers and go visit with them. Now, traditionally in the past, we might have looked at okay, if a person wants to get a job at a grocery store, they're going to need to know how to stock shelves, how to unload the truck, how to maybe take inventory, how to cashier, how to handle money, how to work with customers. And sometimes it's not, it, you know, a person might have a lot of skill set, but maybe they don't know how to work with the cash register. So that job would have automatically been, no, they're out. But now we're really looking at working with employers on a more customized level and saying, all right, where are the areas you have needs that maybe you have struggles to try to fill those needs or to get those jobs done? So we now have people using the grocery store as an example that maybe just do the shelf stocking because they're really good at that. They aren't expected to work on the cash register. So their hours might be designed around when does the stock come in and when does it need to get on the shelf. And that's what they're focusing on, that's what they're good at. It's a great value to the employer and it works for everybody concerned. So it's really individualized once you get out in the community. Another way that we're trying to discover those talents and also fill employer need, we take small groups of individuals to the work site to get a job done. A good example there is we work with Mariani Packaging. And from time to time, they have a project that their regular workforce is already doing what they're doing, but they might have a special re-inspection or some special project that they need to get done. And we will arrange to have a group of people there for maybe it's a 2-week period, or maybe it's a 6-week or 3-month period. But we're there, we're providing the support in all of those cases, either a job coach or a trainer of some sort is there with the people to make sure that they're getting the job done according to the employer's expectations and also that they're supporting the people's training needs at the same time. So a lot of ways that we can accomplish the win-win and getting people out into the community.
Now these individuals will receive a paycheck from a local business and as well as working at ODC, is that correct?
Right. Whatever they're doing, if they're working, they're getting paid. There's a lot of ways that we can accomplish that too, for example, with the work crew. Rather than the employer putting them on their payroll, which can be cumbersome and maybe not necessary because it's a temporary assignment, they're still on ODC's payroll and we'll just work out a billing arrangement. Sometimes when a person is getting a job in the community, there's a period of time called a work experience where they're not on the employer's payroll. The employer doesn't have any obligation to them other than they're giving them a period of time to try out a job. That person's getting paid, but it's through our program and through some of our funding sources that they're getting paid. And then there are times when an employer at the end of that will say, oh my goodness, I need to hire this person, they're wonderful. So they'll hire the person and put them on their payroll. So that works out well. Sometimes the person will continue on ODC's payroll and we're just kind of the middleman, I guess, for lack of a better word. We're kind of helping to make sure the person is getting paid. We'll bill the employer then for whatever the payroll amount is. So,
well, this looks like a great opportunity for our community, for the individuals themselves to get out. So it's a win-win for not only ODC and the people, but local businesses and people out here in the community that shop at those businesses. Mm-hmm. So let's talk about how ODC makes money. Just doesn't grow on trees. You do sell some products, but that's not going to fund the entire operation. You have well over probably 100, 200 people there, employees and mm-hmm. individuals. Let's talk about how the funding comes in for ODC.
Well, we have three categories of funding, and the first, as you mentioned, is sales. So anything that is produced, a good or a service that comes out of our facilities, we have a customer. Just like any business, we would sell the goods, and we have to pay to all the material costs, all the payroll costs, all of the lights, heat, equipment, all of those things. For whatever we are selling, the customers are helping us to mm-hmm. to cover those and hopefully come out with a little at the end of the day in terms of profit. As a not-for-profit organization, if we do generate profit, it just really helps to support the mission. So the more profit you have, the more mission you can accomplish. The second area of funding is what is known as fee-for-service. The people that come to us don't pay a fee to come, but we are funded through contracts with the Division of Vocational Rehabilitation or organizations like Community Care Connections of Wisconsin. which I guess in a nutshell that trickles down from federal and state monies that are there to fund services for people with disabilities. You know, that's what some of our tax dollars go to, is actually making sure that people who have disabilities have opportunities. So, and how that all happens from the federal down to the state down to the, it, that's what it's really there for. So ODC has a fee for, let's say we're going to get a person a job in the community. There's, you know, we get paid to do those types of things. We would get paid to get the person the job and also get paid to support the job once the person's on the job. And then the third area would be donations. As a not-for-profit, that is always an important part of the mix for most not-for-profits. And we are very fortunate. We have a lot of community support. We're, the community will get behind us if we need to purchase equipment to do a job, or we need to purchase vehicles to get people out in the community. Whatever it is, we will utilize the donors' money to make sure that we're accomplishing our mission.
Let's talk a little bit about the funding again, Pam. It's federal and state. I hear there's some changes that are going to happen, possible changes.
Right. We're experiencing right now some pretty troubling, impending news, I guess you could call it. On a federal and state level, in a nutshell, there is the consideration that funding for anything that happens within a facility-based program could be eliminated over the course of a very short period of time, as long as 5 years, but probably not even that long. And the what's behind this potential policy change is that the federal government is really looking at the settings where people with disabilities live, spend their time, where they work. They want to make sure that people with disabilities are given every opportunity to be integrated in the community, be involved in a full citizenship role in the community. When you, again, take a step back in time, you can picture maybe where some of this is coming from, where people with disabilities didn't have a lot of opportunities, and in the olden days they were institutionalized and maybe really held back, never had the opportunity to try something, to be in the community, to work in the community. And over the course of time, that's really been looked at quite seriously. And I understand that. That's an important thing. We should be giving people with disabilities every opportunity that we all have to live and work and be part of our community. Where I think they're taking it a step too far is they're starting to define those settings where people can work, and they ultimately want to see as many people working in the community as possible, in an individual, regular job, side by side, working with people without disabilities. And we're all for that too. But where it's going too far is that in order to get there, the policy setters are saying what we need to do is really take a look at these places where people are congregated and define them as somehow segregating people. A facility-based program, like part of ODC's programs, is viewed as that possibility of, are we segregating people? Are we somehow not giving them an opportunity to be part of the community? Are we holding them back in any way? My adamant answer to that question is no, we are not. ODC and many of our fellow agencies like ODC throughout the state and nation are very progressive. Our work centers are really intended to be a place where people can learn, where they can gain work skills, where we're continuously reviewing opportunities for them to be part of the community workforce. If they want to get a job out in the community, we're working with them to do that. We're working with them to figure out what types of support they would need to be part of the community and work at a job in the community. But if that's what somebody wants, we're working with them. So really, to me, it's about, are we giving them those opportunities to access the community? Absolutely, yes. All of our programs are really designed to try to do that. But if the policy setters view that setting and saying, well, that's a segregated setting, therefore it's not eligible for any funding through Medicaid dollars, then the state, who uses some of those Medicaid dollars to fund Wisconsin's organizations like ODC that contract with the state, they could stop funding it as well. And what I think is going to happen as a result is not that more people will get jobs out in the community. It will just mean that those individuals for whom it's the toughest to get a job in the community because of the severity of their disability and the significance of their need might end up not working. Where now, today, they're enjoying being able to come to work every day at a place that they feel valued, that they have coworker friendships, they have a lot of great opportunities, and somehow that being viewed negatively to me is just really unfortunate, because it's an array of services that places like ODC offers. We're not all about facility-based work, and we're doing a lot in the community. We've more than doubled our community. The number of people working in the community over the last 5 years has greatly expanded, and that's due to effort and a lot of community employers being willing to work, you know, hire somebody and work with ODC. But it's really about that array and having choices. And we believe that all choices are good, and they should be left to the individual, not to the government, to decide. It's kind of like if you went to a restaurant and you saw your menu of choices and you could pick, I want this and this and this. It's kind of how it is now. What it could be is, well, I want this, but it's no longer on the menu. So I have to pick, either I work in the community, and if that's not a possibility, or if it's not, I don't have enough hours, or maybe I haven't gotten a job, or I'm really struggling to get a job, or I lose my job. The only other alternative is to wait until you get another job or get more hours or do some other non-work activity. Our day services programs are kind of that non-work activity, and they'll be community-based. You know, we're taking people to expose them to a lot of different things in the community. We're volunteering in the community. A lot of really great things happening, but for some people and for you and I, that wouldn't be enough. I want to work, and so do a lot of the people we're working with. So it's a troubling trend. We've been hearing for the last couple years some rumblings about it, and now it's getting much closer. Right now, the state of Wisconsin is putting together their plan for how they will comply with the federal policy so that they can continue to get this Medicaid dollars to help fund programs. But without knowing exactly what the federal government's policy is going to be, it kind of puts Wisconsin in a bad place, and it certainly puts us in a very questionable position. I want to make sure to emphasize this isn't about ODC or about funding or about our programs. It really does come down to the people that will be affected. So we're asking, and we had some stakeholder meetings last week, to talk to the individuals that would be affected and tell them, this is what could happen. Please write a letter. That right now the Department of Health Services in Wisconsin has a 30-day period during the month of August where we can comment on their plan. And their plan right now is really inconclusive. It's really incomplete. It doesn't spell out what will happen to facility-based funding. Will it go away? Will it stay with some caveats? What's going to happen? And the plan is very unclear. So to have 30 days to comment on something that's unclear, first of all, if it's going to affect you, it's very troubling. If you don't know what's going to happen to you as a result, having this 30-day window doesn't give you much of an opportunity to comment. But what we're asking people to do, if they are so inclined, is to make comments and preserve that array of choices, that whole menu, so that people that want to work in the community, let's do it. Let's get them working in the community if they want to work in the facility, because that's where they feel best suited and best supported. That should be an option for people, and it really should be, any and all of those choices should be preserved.
Community support, that's what we need right now. They could write a letter this month, the month of August, explaining their support for having workers come to their place, and without you guys, most likely they're not going to get there. It's very difficult for someone just to pick up and get a job without someone helping them with the skills, especially people that may have those some certain disabilities, but they're really strong in another area, like we were talking earlier in the show. If it could be stocking shelves and all that, you guys know that you can get them in the right position right now. versus them trying to do that on their own, or with their parents' help or a guardian. Not as easy.
Right.
This is a great opportunity. But so the community step forward, write a letter, or just really offering the support to hire these individuals for
right.
something that might be a permanent job, a temporary job. It could be as simple as cleaning some yards and raking and things like that, you know, that all that kind
right.
of stuff. I'm sure there's so many jobs out there.
If people are interested in hearing more on this topic or have questions about it, I would encourage them to call us, because then we can explain a little bit more in detail what's happening or what could be happening. The real point is every person is unique, and our mantra has been one size does not fit all. So what might be right for one person necessarily isn't right for another person. And every family member and every person knows. They know what's best for them or what they really want, what works in their lives, and they ought to be able to continue to choose that. We do need the community's moral support, for sure. If they want to write letters and comment, those comments have to be in writing so that the Department of Health Services can demonstrate and prove that they have taken public input. And then they are told that they need to listen to that public input and modify their plan accordingly. So we're just urging people, please, to make comments that they believe that having a full array of choices is better for people with disabilities than having choices eliminated when there's really not a great plan for what will happen. We're not going to leave people on their own. ODC will continue to work with people to get them a job in the community. If that's the only option that we're, you know, that's available, we'll continue to try to work with people. But we do know that for some individuals, that's going to be really difficult. The level of support need that they might have to actually be able to function effectively and successfully in a community environment is really, that's what makes me nervous. You know, we want everybody to succeed, but we know that it might not be feasible for everybody to get that full job in the community. What is their day and their life going to look like if they don't have that steady opportunity to go to work like they do now? When they come to work at ODC, they know what to expect every day. They have a routine, they have things to look forward to. That uncertainty of not knowing what's going to happen throughout your day is, again, that's the troubling part of not knowing really what the policy setters are going to say.
Well, let's hope for the best here moving forward, but a community can get out to help. Let's switch gears a little bit, talk about internship. We got a little bit more time. You have a new program. High school interns can do something over at ODC, is that correct?
Right. ODC was one of seven cities, in Wisconsin Rapids. Wisconsin Rapids was one of seven new sites in Wisconsin to be selected to do a project search program. And this is a national model. It's a high school internship model that involves students with disabilities in their last year of high school who are part of Project Search. Rather than going to school that year, what they do is go to a work site that is a work site partner. Wisconsin Rapids is going to, the Wisconsin Rapids Public School System will be one of the partners. Riverview Hospital is going to be the worksite partner. So these students will go to Riverview Hospital every day, and part of their day will be spent in a classroom style setting where they'll talk about everything to do with employment readiness, talk about what skills they need on the job, and a teacher will be there with them. But the big part of their day is the internship. They will, each student during the course of the school year will have three different 10-week unpaid internships in various departments within the hospital, whatever again is more along what their interests are. And ODC's part in that partnership then is to provide the support and job coaching during those internships. So it's really, it's about a five-way partnership. It's the school district, Riverview Hospital, ODC, Division of Vocational Rehabilitation is one of the funders, and then Community Care Connections of Wisconsin is the fifth partner, and they are a funding source too. It is a phenomenal program. We've seen it in action because we do this, we're involved in one in Marshfield. Those students at the beginning of that school year and at the end of that school year, it's such an amazing transformation because they've had some challenging, real, high expectation type internship experiences. They are really much more ready to work when they get done with that school year. there's a graduation ceremony. It's really, really inspiring when you see how these kids become adults in the course of this program and over the course of the year. So our program will actually be starting not this fall, but next fall. This year, we're one of, like I said, seven cities that will be involved in it. We're all going to be involved in intensive training and planning for a year to make sure we get it off the ground, that we really, all the partners know what their part is and how this all operates, and we can have a really successful outcome for those students.
Alrighty. Well, thanks for all that information, Pam. Really appreciate you coming by the studio today and sharing that information with us and our viewers. It's great.
Thank you.
All right. Thanks again.